But I must ask you one little thing I've read since lunch. It says you broke into the art world when you were 30 with the temptation of St. Anthony. Could you tell us something about that? What was that?
Это очень плохая работа.
Well, that's what I read. So the point is, when I procured this catalog and was eager to discover everything about Victor, I suddenly discovered that, in fact, in the late 70s, I believe, already, he emigrated to Prague. He said that he emigrated on the wings of love. And this was, of course, love for his beautiful wife, Milena Slavika,
whom
I discovered is a very distinguished... Oh, dear. Well, anyway, distinguished art historian from Prague, obviously at the time very young and dynamic. And a protege of someone whose name I will mispronounce, Halupeki.
Протеже человека, имя которого я, видимо, неправильно произнес.
Halupeki being one of the first Czech art historians.
Один из первых чешских искусствоведов.
Who had traveled to Moscow and published a pioneering article about Moscow conceptualism in Studio International around about 1974. So there was this big moment, and of course, when after the very famous bulldozer show, when the government bulldozed the show in the open air, I don't know if you were involved in that show.
No.
Anyway, after that show, various artists emigrated, but I think you were the sole artist of that cluster of people who went to Prague.
Yes.
And Milena says to me that at that time in Prague, as my good friend Clara knows so well, contemporary art was about photography, performance. And you felt again isolated and different. Milena introduced you to the Czech underground. And you finally exhibited with painters from Prague. But I think even I think all the works in this exhibition were made in exile. Is that correct? Indeed. So you stayed with your Russian mindset in Prague.
Это так.
Could you say a little bit about the beginnings of your period in Prague?
О начале своей жизни пражской.
Дело в том, что когда я переехал в Прагу, то я, конечно, не осознавал, что со мной происходит.
When I moved to Prague, I could hardly understand or realize what indeed was happening to me.
Только спустя годы я стал понимать, какая это была драма.
Only years later I could understand what kind of drama I was going through.
Я потерял круг общения.
I lost my immediate circle of friends.
Я потерял своего зрителя.
I lost my audience.
И эти первые годы были очень тяжелые. Они, с одной стороны, были очень счастливые, потому что это годы такой прекрасной, возвышенной любви.
And these first years were very difficult years. On the one hand, they were extremely happy years and lofty years, because these were the years of love, of most divine love.
Я имею в виду и Милену, и Прагу.
I mean both Milena and the city of Prague.
И Прагу я, конечно, воспринимал как такой символ западной культуры.
And of course, Prague for me was in a way a symbol of Western culture.
For me, this is a very Kafkaesque insect-like drawing. I particularly like this.
Is работа вот эта.
Это это Достоевский, это не Достоевский.
Well, it's got a little bit of creepy crawliness in it, and I don't necessarily associate with Dostoevsky.
Получение метаморфозное.
Вот. И поэтому дело в том, что я был как художник первые годы совершенно потерян.
So as an artist, I was completely lost. For the first few years.
И только постепенно я начал выходить на какую-то дорогу, которая, так сказать, меня. Я почувствовал твердую почву под ногами.
And only slowly, gradually, I was coming to a point where I could finally feel some ground beneath my feet.
И вывел меня на эту дорогу русский язык.
And the thing that actually drove me to that firmness was the Russian language.
Which you retained and you spoke with whom at the beginning?
Которую вы сохранили в себе и с кем вы общались на русском языке тогда?
Ну, этот круг общения был небольшой, но дело не в этом. Я,
the circle of communication wasn't very big, but...
Во-первых, я часто ездил в Москву.
I was coming to Moscow quite frequently.
I see.
И поддерживал связи с тем кругом, так сказать, моих друзей.
And I was still in very close contact with my immediate circle of friends.
Но потом произошла такая вещь, что весь этот круг друзей сам разъехался по всему миру.
Then what happened that all of my friends were dispersed all over the globe.
И тогда эти постепенно эти связи слабели и слабели.
And these connections, these ties were growing weaker and weaker, kind of dissolving.
So I think in terms of our friends who are standing up for a start, I must accelerate to the moment, a recent moment of miracle, where you meet a beautiful young Russian philosopher who is in Prague.
Чудесный, когда вы познакомились с замечательным русским философом, который жил в Праге.
Who is Olga Serebryanaya?
Ольга Серебряная.
Whose name is related to the word silver? You think is particularly beautiful. Her name.
Понятно, что это серебро связано.
When you met her, you brought her a list of books she has not as yet written, which I think is a very funny idea.
Список книг, которые еще.
It would be nice if someone did that to me.
Которые она еще не написала. Было бы здорово, если кто-нибудь такой подарок.
And this latest exhibition, which has just opened a few days ago in Frankfurt.
Несколько дней тому назад в Франкфурте.
Is about this interchange, but it commemorates.
Эта книга это между этого.
It's a moment which is continuing,
который продолжается.
Which is a very strange exercise in time and space.
Очень странное такое упражнение во времени и пространстве.
Because it is a very, very extended correspondence, although a correspondence by email.
Бесконечная переписка, долгая по электронной.
It is almost like an 18th century conversation in writing about philosophy.
Эпистолярный роман 18 века, в котором люди обменивались мыслями философскими.
And before we met today, I had seen your images in one catalog. But this morning I read this extraordinary correspondence about philosophy.
Эту переписку вашу философскую.
Because Olga was a philosophy teacher in St. Petersburg. She is now a translator in Prague, translating from the English into Russian. And you have found a kindred spirit with whom to exchange your most profound ideas in a way that one could say is shamelessly intellectual.
То есть в таком вот бесстыдно интеллектуальном, что ли.
Inasmuch as the kind of emails we are all used to exchanging with each other are not about Plato, Spinoza, Descartes, the problem of Plato expelling the artist from the city. The repertoire of art historical images you have in your head. How one reads today David's Marat as an image of our own death. And in particular, she writes about iPads and iPhones and the extension of what Pivorovov calls the Eon Bank, the kind of bank of knowledge of the Eon in the web. And it really is rather extraordinary, this exchange. And it shows you, if I hadn't read it and I had just encountered you today, and I would think you're a jolly nice chap and a Moscow conceptualist, you've demonstrated to me once again this great difference and separation, which is what fascinates me about you and your generation in Moscow.
Что отличает вас и ваше поколение московских художников?
Because in a way in which someone of your own generation in England would not engage in this kind of correspondence.
Ваши сверстники здесь в Британии вряд ли видели бы такого рода.
There is a very, very moving engagement with the whole tradition of European humanism. There is a discourse between generations. This woman is 40 years old, apparently. She too is impregnated with this, and also there's a very interesting relationship between the European tradition and the names I've already cited, but they're two favorite Moscow philosophers, one of whom I actually knew before, who's got a Georgian name, Mamardashvili, and the other one who's Pyatigorsky. Now when Olga is doing what she normally does for a living, M and P are Putin and Medvedev. And I thought when I was reading this it was Matisse and Picasso, but it's actually these two. It's actually these two very important philosophers, Mamardashvili and Pyatigorsky, and there's this passionate conversation about them. And of course, for most Londoners, even some Russian people here, they are not our pillow books. We don't know what they are talking about. I know that they came together in 1982 in Jerusalem and published a book called Symbol and Consciousness. I have a way through Olga of ending this evening, but before I do, perhaps you could say, in relationship to both the very expressionist drawings we see here with their fragments of bodies, their fragments of narrative, the role of the empty space, which is very poignant, and the works upstairs, which are more graphically put together. Could you say for us a little bit the role of M and P, of Mamardashvili and Pyatigorsky, how they inform for you your work?
Дело в том, что Мамардашвили я живым не застал. Он умер довольно давно.
He died quite a long time ago.
А с Пятигорским мы общались.
And you, Пятигорский,
И он последние 30 лет жил в Лондоне.
He lived here in London for the last 30 years of his life.
Был профессором Лондонского университета.
He was a professor of a university here in London.
Он был индолог и буддолог.
His specialty was Hindu studies and Buddhist studies.
Goodness me.
И кроме того, был писатель.
And he was also a writer.
Какая, если очень коротко сказать, что, так сказать, нового внесли эти два философа?
I'm trying to kind of sum it up what these two philosophers, what was their contribution.
Они внесли очень старое.
They brought in something which was actually really old.
Сократовский дух.
The spirit of Socrates.
Философию как живую беседу.
Philosophy as a living conversation.
С любым человеком.
As a live conversation with any person, with anybody else.
И вот это вот они, так сказать, это была огромная заслуга их.
And that was their greatest achievement.
И особенно если, конечно, учесть, так сказать, режим Советского Союза.
The Soviet regime.
Это было окно свободы.
It was a window of freedom.
Поэтому я не могу сказать конкретно, допустим, что философия Мамардашвили и Пятигорского, как она отражается в каких-то рисунках.
Мамардашвили and Пятигорский's philosophy informed by particular drawings.
Но идея диалога, идея живого разговора,
the idea of a conversation, of a live communication,
есть и в этих альбомах, которых я вам рассказывал,
in the albums that I was telling you about,
и в этих рисунках,
and in these drawings.
And was there not? I read here, but I can't remember what it said. There was a kind of very funny etymological explanation of the word dialectic, which is very different. Which is very different from our idea of dialectical materialism. It's this new neoplatonic idea of dialogue.
Дело в том, что я знаю, что такая есть, но я сейчас не могу вспомнить.
Yes, I do know that it's there, but I can't remember what it was.
Oh, you can't remember either. Anyway, it was a revelation to me. What's the actual etymology of dialectic?
Это надо у Ольги спросить.
But no, Maria's here. Couldn't Maria tell us? Maria? Or maybe she isn't. Maybe she had to go. We have a lovely Greek Russian-speaking lady from the Courtauld who could have told us. So the point is, strangely enough, your dialogue with Olga begins with the idea of not being able to write, not being able to draw. Artists who don't draw. And this kind of pain of the compulsion, almost like forced labor of the artist's work.
Принудительный труд, который должен делать художник.
So what looks to us so spontaneous,
для нас выглядит совершенно легким и спонтанным,
has actually involved
на самом деле
a lot of thought and process and labor.
Мыслительного процесса и тяжелого труда.
Да, эти, так сказать, переписка наша с Ольгой начинается с этого письма.
Yes, our correspondence with Olga does indeed start with this with a letter like this.
Это не само начало переписки, это оно началось раньше, но в этом каталоге оно это письмо открывает.
What our correspondence had started with, but this is in what the book is.
Oh, I see. Yes, what the book started.
И мы поднимаем проблему,
raising a problem.
Чем отличается картина, которую нарисовал художник?
What's different between the picture that the artist drawn?
От так называемой ментальной картины.
From a so-called mental picture.
От той картины, которую каждый из нас, допустим, на лоне природы, или в горах, или у моря, воспринимает как совершенное произведение искусства.
From what each and every one of us, when we are traveling, when we see a beautiful landscape, be it on the beach or in the mountains, and we see it as a perfection of nature. What's different between those two?
вот в отличие от физической картины, мы называем ее ментальной картиной.
So, to differentiate it from the physical object, we call it a mental picture.
Что с ней происходит, с этой ментальной картиной?
What's happening with this mental picture?
Исчезает ли она после того, как, допустим, человек, который видел этот прекрасный пейзаж, в момент, когда он уснет?
Does it dissipate or disappear once a person who had seen this beautiful picture falls asleep?
And also there are thousands of unrealized, unpainted pictures.
Okay.
And thousands of unwritten books.
Не написанных картин и тысячи не написанных книг.
Совершенно
so this
верно.
Takes us back to the idea of the tip of the iceberg is what we see.
Верхушки айсберга, это то, что мы видим.
Да, но я склоняюсь к мысли Платона.
Plato,
о его учениях об эйдосах.
Who was talking about эйдос? He's teaching about эйдос.
Эйдос – это идея.
Эйдос – это идея.
И Платон, так же как и многие другие уже позже него.
Plato, as well as many others, much later.
Утверждали, что эта ментальная картина не исчезает.
An unwritten novel does not disappear.
This is what they're also this were very wonderful for all of us who are writing enormous theses or doctorates or books that haven't been written because there's this idea that these are as valuable unwritten as if they were written, which is a very comforting idea. So the point is, I do want the audience to be able to ask you some questions. So on this point of the unwritten, the Platonic idea, the humble realizations that are just a fraction of the millions of things we could draw or write. I'd just like to end with a phrase from Olga, whom I long to meet, incidentally, who leaves us with the reality of the unwritten and the possibility, the reality of the unwritten and the possibility of a rhinoceros in the room. I think it's a quote, an intimation of Ionesco, but on that idea, it isn't.
No, это связано с.
It's a Soviet rhinoceros.
Со спором Витгенштейна и Бертрана Рассела.
It's a Bertrand Russell.
And Bertrand
well, I knew it was something.
Утверждал.
So Russell
утверждал, что в этой комнате нет носорога.
So it's a more English rhinoceros than I thought.
Витгенштейн утверждал, что в этой комнате может быть носорог.
There could be a rhinoceros
in the room. Just as I was very surprised about Soviet miniature elephants. Okay, so with this putative rhinoceros, I would like to ask the audience if they have any questions for Victor, and I think my role has now come to an end.
И моя роль на этом завершена, поэтому я с удовольствием предоставлю возможность зрителям, слушателям задать вопросы.
How do these unrealized images, which remain in your consciousness, relate to your work? Why are we talking about it now?
Because I wanted to end with the rhinoceros. And it's very important for him, actually.
Как они связаны? Но я думаю, что нереализованных картин или нереализованных проектов гораздо больше, чем я способен это сделать.
I think that there are many more unrealized projects, unrealized and painted paintings that I could have physically finished and realized or have painted in the course of my life.
Вопрос в том, что происходит с этими нереализованными идеями.
The question is, what happens to these unrealized ideas?
Мне очень нравится история о китайском поэте.
I'm very fond of this story about a Chinese poet.
Который писал стихи на опавших осенних листьях.
was writing his poetry on the fallen leaves, autumn leaves.
И пускал эти листья по ручью.
And let these leaves float along the stream, the creek.
От него не осталось ни одной строки.
Not a single line he'd written survived.
Осталась только эта история.
There's just this wonderful story.
И это высшее, что может быть в искусстве.
And this is the most sublime kind of poetry.
Yes, yes. Well, thank you so very much, Victor. I think that was a beautiful conversation.
Thank you very much, Victor, and to, of course, Alex for interpreting. Please make your way back upstairs if you'd like to the room on the first floor. If you'd like to have another drink, please.